If you got your Bibles tonight, turn to 2 Corinthians chapter number 10, please. It's good to be here. 2 Corinthians 10, stand with you, would you please? I'm going to address something tonight I think will be a help to you. It helped me, and it's going to help me again when I preach it. And verse number 1, I'll read down through verse number 6. I got a thought for you tonight. I'll try to get done on time for y'all's eating. Hot dogs got chili and slaw. And okay. Going to have cookies? I thought so. We'll be eating cookies till December 25th. Amen. Now, I, Paul, myself beseech thee you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, who in presence am I based among you, but being absent, I am bold towards you. Now, let me give you a little thought here, and this is not my message. They were a little aggravated, Paul. Because when he was around them, he seemed sweet to them. But when he went away from them, he had what they called a poison pen. And he was kind of bold to them. But listen to this. But I beseech you that I may not be bold when I'm absent with that confidence wherewith I think to be bold against some which think of us as if we walked according to the flesh. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. Now notice, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God.
Amen.
To the pulling down of strongholds.
Yes.
Casting down imaginations.
Amen.
And every high thing that exalteth himself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, and having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Our Father, I ask you now to help me to preach with power.
Yes.
I know there's folks in here that are dealing with what I'll be preaching on.
Yeah.
I know it. I'm aware of it.
Yeah.
And I pray, God, tonight you'll help me as I explain the scriptures.
Yeah.
And expound the scriptures and do an exegesis of the scriptures.
Yeah.
I pray you'll help me
to
help others.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, for his sake, amen.
Amen.
If you study the book of 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians, and you study the time lapse, Paul spent approximately a year and a half at the Crift Church. And he built a church there, planted a church there, in amongst a wicked group of church people. You can't get no worse than they were. In chapter number 1, he dealt with their sins. Sounds like the modern church, if you ask me. I mean, they had fornication there. Come on. They had division there. They had people committing incest there. They had false doctrine there about the resurrection and baptizing people for the dead. Sound like a bunch of Mormons? Oh, I'm coming. Don't worry. They're a mess. They're all getting drunk at communion. They were suing one another. How many believe that's a mess? Well, he seemed to get it straightened out in 1 Corinthians, and even the person that committed the fornication got right if you read 2 Corinthians. And somebody has told me, and Lord, I don't mean to run a rabbit, but I'm going to run my mouth here, that we cannot build a great church in the era that we're in because people are too wicked. They ain't no more wicked than they were. I still believe we can build a church and change people's life even in this world that's so wicked. Y'all with me? I'm going somewhere. Y'all stay with me. But now, 2 Corinthians is a little bit different. Now, he's still attacking sin. But he wasn't dealing with sin, all those individual sins. But what he actually was dealing with was he was dealing with personal attacks from his critics. So what is, there was a crowd in there that doubted his authenticity and doubted his legitimacy. And they were heretics, and they had crept into the church, and he just got in their grill. By the way, I still think we need some preachers to get into people's grill that ain't doing right, who's trying to sow discord, who are heretics, and don't want to, well, serve God. Now, listen, stay with me, because I got something good today. So in the midst of this, then he's confronted with another issue. He's going to deal with an issue. And here's the issue. And that is the issue of strongholds in Christians' lives. Someone help me. And what he's going to tell them, the reason you're not obeying God and surrendering God is that you got a stronghold. And it's got a hold of you. Ladies and gentlemen, I've been preaching for 41 years in the same church, and I've never seen anything like the strongholds that are in people's lives tonight that absolutely has got to bow down to where they cannot even obey God and live a fulfilled Christian life. Somebody help me. You say, what is a stronghold? It's a fortress. It's a bulwark. It's a structure. Really what it is, it's the works of Satan. It's a fortress of resistance. I'm going to say this. As long as you have strongholds in your life, you'll never obey God. And you'll never be effective in your Christian life. You ain't gonna do it. You may have a desire to really be effective. You will not be effective as long as you have that stronghold in your life. Good preaching, Reverend. Let me expand a little more. Because I'm preaching tonight on the pulling down of strongholds. I ask you a question, do you have a stronghold? You said, what is it? It might be a habit. It might be a besetting sin. It might be a false doctrine. It might be a vice of yesterday. It might be a generational thing that's been passed from your parents to you. Because the Bible does say the sins of the parents are passed to the children. Good preaching, Reverend. See, I want to tell you what I see. I see a lot of Christians that are living afraid. They can't get out of the rut. They say, preacher, I know it's wrong, but I can't get over it. I can't get victory. It's a stronghold. It's embedded in me. Well, tonight I want to see us do business with God. And I want to see God deliver you from your stronghold. Somebody help me. Don't you die on me tonight, because I got some good stuff. Let me give you three or four things and I'll be done. Number one, I want you to notice in verse 1 and 2, the essence of warfare. All of us, whether you're a preacher or not a preacher, you are an ambassador of Jesus Christ. Come on now. And Paul said it. We are at war, Lois. We're at war. First of all, he talks about a proper composure. He said, we're at war. First of all, notice Paul's gentle appeal. He came to them gently. He really did. When he was in their presence, he was gentle to them. And his gentle appeal was this. I want you to get that eradicated out of your life. That jealousy, that lust, that bitterness, that alcohol, that pornography. I know Christianity is not a cakewalk. And I want you to get delivered from that stronghold. I want to see you have it pulled down, demolished, destroyed. That you don't have to live like that anymore. You don't have to open up your computer to pornography. You don't have to go out of here tonight a nervous wreck and get on your opioids and shoot a needle in your arm and drink some alcohol to get your nerves settled. No, you can rest in Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Ghost can deliver you. In verse 2, I see a poise, confrontation, a gracious approach, but also a poise, confrontation. You know what Paul said to him? He said, don't make me have to come down there. That's what he said. Don't make me have to come down there. Hey, some of y'all better not make me have to come to your house and empty your refrigerator out. Yeah, no, don't make me come down there. That's what Paul was saying. He said, you think I'm tough on paper? You keep it up, I'm coming down there, and I'm making a house call to you. I wonder if old Baptist, wonder if the staff went to every member tonight, what we'd find in our icebox. I wonder if the staff, all of us, got to come and check your social media and check your devices and see what we found in your devices. Amen. Don't make me come down there. Come on, brother, can't you say amen? I'm glad you came tonight. You're the only amen I'm getting. He gave him a serious warning. He talked to him about a sanctified walk. He talked about a spiritual warring. Ladies and gentlemen, we're wrestling not with flesh and blood. We're wrestling with the unseen things of the world. He said, when I show up in the flesh, I'm not going to fight with you with my intelligence. I'm not going to fight with you with my intellect, but I'm going to come to you in the power of God and the power of the Word of God. Stay with me. I'm going somewhere and I'll help you. Number two, I want to rush. I don't really want to rush, but I want to go on. The effectiveness of our weapons. Look what the Bible said. First of all, before I get to verse 4, I want you to notice verse 3. For we walk in the flesh, but we don't war after the flesh. And he told them some of them were walking in the flesh. Can I say something to you? Please don't make fleshly decisions that will affect your whole life just because your flesh is aroused by something you want. What do you want to do? Get clear out of the will of God. You want your life to get upside down? Good preaching, Reverend. Number two, look at verse 4. Notice this. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They're not fleshly. You cannot win over the devil, and you cannot get your stronghold defeated by your carnality or your flesh, but mighty through God, through the pulling down of strongholds. First of all, I want you to notice the effectiveness of our weapons. They have a powerful source. They're mighty through God. I'm talking about spirit-led. You know what's going on? We got a lot of people trying to get their mess cleaned up, but they're trying to do it through the flesh. That's it. They're trying to do it with the flesh. And Greg, I don't understand it, because see, God said our weapons are not carnal, but they're mighty. I'm going to say this. There's no excuse for any of us to live a defeated life if we're serving a God with mighty weapons. Ain't no excuse. Somebody help me. Y'all with this over there? Hey, there ain't no excuse. If we're using the mighty power of God. And I don't understand why we Baptists have to leave the power of God with a charismatic group or a contemporary group or some kind of fringe group when we had the Holy Ghost before any of them had it.
Amen.
You first time people, don't get nervous. I'll only get worse. I'd be preaching real hard tonight, but I'm a little tired. Say with me. Well, let's look at the character of these weapons. Listen to me carefully. You know, most of Christian life is real simple. Well, but we make it complicated. What's the character of our weapons? Three things. Number one, the Holy Ghost. Now, let me give you a little lesson. When you got saved, you got all the Holy Ghost you'll ever get.
Amen.
Somebody help me preach.
Amen.
That's the indwelling of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Oh, I know there's some folks that said, well, I got to go back and get a second work. No. You got all the Holy Ghost you need.
Amen.
Your problem isn't that you don't have him. The problem is he don't have you. What is the weapon? The Holy Ghost. He sealed you. He's in you. He's effective.
Amen.
All you got to do is yield to him.
Amen.
Let me give you some more. How about the scriptures?
Amen.
Now, I ain't going to get we got some new people here. I want y'all to know, okay? Don't want you to get upset. Don't want you to fall off your rocker. And if you have an NIV or some other Bible, you got the wrong one. I'll give you a King James if you need it. How about y'all? Y'all all right? Okay.
Amen.
So what are you doing? Why? You're trying to run off our new people? No, I want to assure them that this is our weapon. This King James Bible. This inspired word. This infallible word. Along with the Holy Ghost, we got the Bible. We got the truth. You know what's wrong in all these churches in this era? They done left the Bible. They done left the Holy Ghost. They done left what works. I say to you, you want to pour it out of you? You got to have the Bible. Say it again, sister. There you go. You ain't going to win over the devil with no ESV, NIV, HIV. You're going to win over the devil with the inspired book. And I'll get some hate mail over that, but I don't even give a flip. There's a third thing. That's supplication. You want to overcome it? You overcome it with the scripture. You overcome it with the spirit. But you overcome it with supplication. There ain't nothing like the power of prayer.
Amen.
I want all y'all to know something. There's not a stronghold you have that the Holy Spirit, the scripture, and prayer won't deliver you. Amen.
Good,
am I preaching all right? I see a powerful source. Verse 5, I see a positive success. Look here. I want y'all to see this. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. A positive success. The casting down. What? Where's it start at? Now, y'all stay with me. Inward casting. Now, here's what the problem is. There are too many of you trying to get the outside fixed, and you ain't got the inside fixed. Why is it some of our preachers, all they do is deal on the outside? I say you get the inside clean, you'll start affecting the outside.
Amen.
Now, listen carefully. Casting down the imaginations. Now, I want to say this strong. The stronghold that you have tonight, whatever it is resonating in your mind. Somebody help me. You want to know why you can't stay focused? You want to know why you can't conquer it? It's resonating in this mind of yours, and you have not inwardly cast it down. You still have lustful thoughts. You still have wayward reasoning.
Amen, preacher.
And it's got to be conquered out of the mind, and you got to run it out of the mind. But you can't run it out of your mind as long as you're putting that wicked stuff in. You want to run it out of your mind? Hide the Word of God in your heart. You want to run it out of your mind? Yield to the Holy Spirit of God. You want to run it out of your mind? You pray that God deliver your mind. Am I preaching? The world tells you you have to have all this 12-step program. Come on now. We have a frontline addiction program. It's not a 12-step program. You say, what is it? Watch. It's a one-step program. We're getting Jesus in our lives. Somebody help me. Ain't nothing gonna conquer your sin like Jesus. Ain't nobody can help you like Jesus. You can go to all them steps and do all that reformation. It will not do anything until you get cleansed in your mind. Am I doing all right, Chad? These people, their minds are warped. Come on now. Listen to rap. Oh, you listen to rap. You say, well, I'm not saying the curse words, but I want you to know whether you're saying the curse words in your rap or not, it's affecting you. You listen to your rock and roll. You say, well, I'm not listening to all that death and all that stuff. I'm not paying no attention to it, but you're listening to it, and it will affect you. Am I preaching? We all want to please God, but we create excuses. Preacher, you just don't know what I'm dealing with. Oh, I know what you're dealing with. You're dealing with sin. You're dealing with filthy imaginations. Everything's right here. I read a book when I was a young Christian, young preacher, by Tim LaHaye, called The Battle for the Mind. What do you think all the commercials on TV is about? Watch them. The battle for the mind. What do you think? How do you think they're pushing a homosexual agenda? Because they're showing two men on TV kissing and two women kissing. And you just got, boy, that's your favorite sitcom. Quiet in here now. Done killed a half a dozen Baptists. Oh, you want to be clean, but you're going to watch that bunch of fruitcakes. You watch all that stuff, that gender stuff, and change your gender and do all that junk. Hey, girls, look at me. You're girls. You too. What are you? What? Well, that's kind of weak. Say it loud. Boys, girls. Not boys and not girls. And you need to train your kids. Hey, if you got a boy, train him to be a boy. And you got a girl, train her to be a girl. Hello? Knock, knock. Who's there? You ain't, obviously. What's wrong with us? No, we've let that cross culture, ungodly culture, start guiding us, and we now think we had to follow it instead of us being victorious in the blood of Jesus. I can just see them Fruit Loops when they listen to this message. Hello. I know what's coming. I'll give me some hate mail this week. Somebody will take me off their social media site. Ask me if I care. Now, I'm going to say this to you. You better hear me. You just can't pick and choose where God deals. He wants to deal with all of it. Amen? Then let me show you another thing. Right in verse 5. I see an incredible captivity. Look what he says. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringeth into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Now here's when you go pull down the strongholds. When every thought you think is in obedience to Christ. You cannot go home tonight about 11:30 or 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock and watch your soft porn on Cinemax and don't think it's not going to affect you. And I want to tell all you something. I might as well just run this one a while. Now, you hear me. Some of you think, well, that might make my personal life at home with my wife better. No, all you're trying to do, you're getting baited so you can get, you'll become a sexual pervert. Well, squip them. They done died. I'm preaching. You can't fool with any of it. You got to cast out every imagination, every thought that's not according to Christ. Then you do that, you'll get the bitterness out of your life. You'll get the hatefulness out of your life. You'll get the misery out of your life. But not until. Was it me casting out every thought to obedience? Wonder what this church would be like if all of us had together between the ears. I wonder what it'd be like if every one of us would be in unity. I wonder what this church would be like if all of us would cast down the wicked imaginations and think in unity and clean our mind out. Amen. You couldn't get the people in this place. All teenagers, listen to me. I'm preaching down your alley. You had a lot of victories this weekend. But you know what? You could lose them all tomorrow on your social media. You can lose them all by getting on that little cell phone of yours and looking up some pornography. You can lose them all by chatting with some moron. I'm going to tell you what. Watch out. You look at me right now. You need to quit fooling around with that junk. And you people that's chatting with the opposite sex or the same sex or whatever you're chatting with, get off of it. And get your mind clean. Get your heart clean. Get your life clean. Bathe in the blood of Jesus. Sealed by the Holy Spirit. Yield your mind to God. Amen. I just lost my dignity. I'm almost done, Chad. Number three, and I'm finished. Look at verse 6. Now, here's what I want you to do. Look at it. Y'all there? And having a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. You need an expectation that you are going to win. And you're eager and ready to win. I'm done. I do not believe, stay with me, that I should not get revenge toward you. You or anybody. But I'll tell you what I need to get revenge toward. My disobedience. My wicked disobedience I need to get revenge for it. And then I got to have myself totally obedient and yield myself to Christ. And I'll tell you who you yield yourself servant to. Those are the people. That's what you're going to obey. Somebody help me preach. And there'll be many of you will walk out this door tonight and not do business with God at the altar, because you're going to worry about what's saying in this church, wonder what problem you got. Who cares? And I don't even want to know your problem. But I do want you to come up and yield yourself to God. I don't want you to be miserable any longer. I want you to be victorious and chase it all out of your mind. Stand with me. If you want to go ahead and pray, you come on. But I want to ask, how many of you know you're saved? Raise your hand. How many of you are not sure you're saved? Raise your hand if you're not sure you're saved. How many tonight God helped you in this message? And you need some strongholds out of your life. You want some victory in your life. Raise your hand at me. I want everybody that can come around this altar. Father, touch this invitation. God, give us victory. And we'll praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing.
All to Jesus.
You ought to be here.
All to Him.
You ought to be here.
I will
you ought to be here. Say, I got strongholds. Why are you sitting back here? Get on your knees.
His presence daily live. I surrender.
Oh, yeah.
Can take me, Jesus, take me now.
Yes,
I surrender all. I surrender.